Okay. Thanks, Cha. And I appreciate Dr. Alvin inviting me to share my experience and knowledge. So before I start, let us just break the ice. We celebrated Father's Day in Australia. My son made me a tie, and my daughter baked me a cake. In fact, my wife, when my kids asked me to cut the cake, I told my wife to join me. She was hesitant. I told, without you, I'll not become a father. So said that, please have a look at this. See, a mother sacrifices themselves to take care of the children. Similar to healthcare professionals, especially taking care of the patients at this pandemic when they know there's a risk. I'm very honored, welcome all, to share my experience and knowledge how to make a better health. Okay, let us just to give a background. Just have you guys done scuba diving here? Anyone? Okay. Before you dive, what is your thoughts? Hey, can I trust the coach? Okay, said that, please, next 40 minutes, have an open mind. You're all medical professionals. I'm coming as a ICT professional. I'm going to give a journey how ICT can be complemented with health domain and how we can able to improve the healthcare. That is the objective. So why you must able to listen to me for 40 minutes with an open mind? I have worked in this domain for the last 7 years. I worked in Asia Pac, and especially in health industry, I worked in federal government in Australia, as well as the state government. Plus, I got some additional knowledge working in different domains, because healthcare is a combination of various domains, right from supply chain to service management. So please have an open mind. And to prove myself, I have got a PhD, that too based on the work experience, what I gained working in the enterprise, and a published book, and I published few articles in all available in the Google Scholar. So let us start the journey. So before that disclaimer, in this digital era, one of the key thing, whatever I'm saying now can be outdated in the sense, at the same time, I try to give as much information as possible. Sometimes due to some privacy of my customers, I may not be able to disclose the entire information. Okay. Today's agenda. Today I'll be covering, was healthcare reactive? That is the first thing I'm going to talk about that. Then afterwards, I'll be talking about, as a tactical measure, how telehealth is being used. Then what are the strategies we need to apply further after post-COVID, especially must revisit the health value chain, patient, doctor, and medical student. And the next strategy is using enterprise architecture as an enabler, then using technology as artificial intelligence, digital twin, and especially with the changing pattern of patient authentication. So these are the three things I'm covering. I just highlight the government policy that need to be revisited as I go across. Okay, now, was the healthcare reactive? Let us look at the statistics first. In 2015, the next outbreak was told by Bill Gates. And again, 2017, there was an article saying that there's a next global pandemic can occur anytime. And the most important thing is in 2019, there was a scenario which was set up, and based on that, zoonotic virus was simulated, and they told there'll be a death of about 65 million in 18 months. And again, they predicted this loss is not only for just human loss, even economically, the countries will be disrupted. So next, let us look at, so what is Global Health Security Index? So Global Health Security Index is a consortium. They've taken indexes from 195 countries. So based on that, they come out with the assessment. Based on the assessment, they clearly define that none of the countries are well prepared. And out of that, especially they told 75 countries received a very low scores. So how do they measure? They looked at the preventive measures, what is having, what were the countries were having, and made some detection of the virus and how they're able to respond. And what is the health infrastructure we are having? And one of the key things we observed in pandemic, Many countries don't have the health infrastructure, that is physical infrastructure. At the same time, medical professionals to treat the patients. And then the government policies plus the risk. So based on this, let me just take you to the journey of what is the Global Health Index and how the other countries are, what index other countries are having. As you can see here, Canada has got 75, the index score. US has got 83%. And if you look at Australia, 75. And let us look at Philippines, it is 47. See, what is the message I want to convey here is, countries which had lower index, the death rate was high. At the same time, the countries which are higher index, some countries managed and some countries were complacent. Let us look at it. Why they were complacent? They thought compared to other countries, their infrastructure was better and lack of foresight. And especially the pandemic, what we saw, there's a complete communication collapse and some countries reacted late. And very important thing, lack of data. I'll be covering of how the patient record is maintained, how long it is maintained. I'll be revisiting as I go across. And generally, healthcare industry, they're very conservative in adapting technology. So that is one thing. And second thing is unawareness of the technology capabilities, especially with the current cloud capability, what we are having, and underutilization of the technology by itself. Though they got some technology, but it's not completely utilized for its complete potential. I'm working in the industry for almost 20 years. So because of the licensing model, what we are having, they buy a licensing model that's perpetual based, buy once, use for a lifetime. They don't upgrade, though they pay the maintenance cost very heavily. I'll be discussing as I go across. Let us look at what's happening. See, what happened is, because of COVID, one of the key thing happened is, they tried to, whatever the minimal resources they're having to treat the patient, they utilized in an efficient way. Yes, they're utilizing it. At the same time, what's happening is, they're going towards telehealth. They want to avoid the patients to coming into the hospital to minimize the infection. At the same time, to reduce the load on the health professionals. So of course, I'll not go for what is telehealth and all. I've just highlighted few things. Telehealth, mainly you're utilizing it for diagnosis and treatment. Okay. Continuing education. Please have a pointer on this in your mind. Then research and evaluation. And through telehealth, what are we capturing? Voice, data, images. The current telehealth, how the countries are reactive. The countries went through Skype, WhatsApp, or Facebook, or web tool. And Zoom has become a de facto stand in the industry because it is affordable and sometimes it is free. So this is just a tactical way they approached. Let us look, what is a telehealth market in the future? This is one of the research from McKinsey. What they're saying is in 2019, before COVID, they had only about 11%. With COVID, this is done in May. It has gone to 76%. I think in August, September, I don't know what is the percentage, it might have increased a lot. And so again, the providers, they scaled up almost 175 times. And very important thing, I address the regulatory requirements. Before COVID, the regulatory requirements in especially in developed countries, some of the treatments was not possible to be given by telehealth. So because of COVID-19, so the government, especially in US, they revisited and made 80 new kind of services they approved on telehealth. So based on that index, if you look at the statistics, what they're saying is currently they're having about $3 billion in US. They're estimated to go by $250 billion in the coming years. So in my talk, a presentation I go across, I come across how technology can be complement this to enable this telehealth. At the same time, I'll be how to use the technology with an enterprise architecture approach. I'll be discussing about that. So again, I spoke to a lot of people and a lot of my contacts, one of the key things what's happening is, yes, telehealth they're doing. But in the telehealth, unfortunately, the information that is captured is not enough. Let us take the example of Australia. In Australia, I worked for the New South Wales Health. Here in Australia, we got a Medicaid system. So the government absorbs the cost of the Medicaid. So on that basis, every citizen has got an ID and has got an electronic medical record. But unfortunately, especially in developing countries, this facility is not there. I was looking at one of the statistics. India, 75% of the patient care is done by private healthcare. So said that the records of a telehealth patient is not captured. Even if it's captured, it is just some vital signs or just some conversation. And that too with the WebEx or Zoom, is just a conversation and whatever the patient says. So nothing is captured. So there, what we are trying to offer is that we can able to provide you with HIPAA compliant forms. At least what is our recommendation is, yes, wherever you are treating the patient, please capture the information of the patient. And that is a very useful information for the future. I'll be explaining why it is. Okay, let us look at what is the strategies for the healthcare to manage. See, till now what I spoke was, yes, because of COVID, health industry went for a tactical measure of telehealth. But that is a good opportunity in the long term. So how to manage that, I'll be speaking in the coming slides. So before that, at the same time, I'm talking about what are the strategies to manage effectively and efficiently, that to using technology. So before that, let us visit what is a health value chain. So some of the medical professionals, you might not be knowing what is a value chain. So value chain, I can give an example. You got a wheat. The wheat goes into some kind of a factory. It gets converted and comes as output as a bread. So similarly, a patient goes to your hospital, he gets the treatment. Afterwards, based on his ailment, he may be monitored, followed up, or he might be cured. That is one value chain of a patient journey. Let us look at the value chain of the doctor. The doctor treats the patient as well as he coaches the students. Please take note of this. Then a medical student, he attends the class. So at this moment, it's remote learning, but before that, it was on-site. So again, he attends the clinical sessions, that is wherever is possible. And the current situation or the recommended situation in the future, remote patient interactions. So here the value chain, please take note all of you, the value chain need to be revisited. See, typically, if we take off other education medium, example, it's engineering or it is some arts or science, it is different. But a medical student, he is trained under a doctor, treating a patient or at least assisting a doctor in a hospital. As I know, I think he got X number of beds for a student. So that's how the hospitals are built. One of the hospitals is working in Sydney. It was called Westmead Hospital. It was built for a University of Sydney. So said that, especially because of COVID, unfortunately, students, even access to attend the clinics is very limited. So this need to be revisited. So let us see how it can be done. So what are the strategies we are looking now? The first strategy is the patient care. The patient care is completely changed. It will be a hybrid model in the future. One is hospital visit, and one is telehealth. So based on the above, the education curriculum must be revisited. In the education curriculum, remote learning must be enabled henceforth. Telehealth treatment must be included in the curriculum. Then how to enable this, how to implement this? Yes, definitely must be have an enterprise architecture approach. I'll be discussing why it is needed. Then technology must be enabled. It must complement the healthcare. Without technology, it's not possible to provide an affordable services and to reach the masses. All okay till now? Is the flow okay? Can someone type me a message? I could see a lot of messages coming across.
Yes, Dr. Okay.
Yes. Fine. Oh, great. Okay. Then let me proceed to the next. Okay, let us look at what is enterprise architecture. Some of you have come from enterprise architecture, somebody already know about this. I just briefly tell you an overview. See, let us look at a typical landscape. You'll be surprised. Technology was used in health industry somewhere in 1816, the first time, when a physician took a paper round and able to listen to the heartbeat of a patient. That is what the first time technology was used. See, technology is nothing but some kind of information passed through. Let us look at what is happening now. Again, this is similar way, but using the modern technology, telehealth. You can able to monitor the patient information remotely. Okay, let us look at what is typical landscape. See, health industry has adapted technology, especially developed countries like US or Australia or UK. They spent billions of dollars. Again, the systems have come at various timelines. Because systems have come at various timelines, it has got its own problem. So one of the key things we observed in COVID, access to the information in real time as possible. To enable that, your systems must be interoperable. It must be able to share the information in real time. Unfortunately, the systems what we have is not capable. Again, HL7 is the one mechanism which has the information passing across. It is too complicated. Though we are getting a fire API coming across, it is not well implemented by the vendors. It is slowly taking the traction. So moving forward, companies, especially health industry, must really adapt the technology. To adapt the technology, it must come from enterprise architecture perspective. I'll be explaining the next slide. So what is enterprise architecture? See, every enterprise exists to provide some service. Let us take the service what we provide. If it is a private hospital, they provide a service. At the same time, they want to run the hospital. Is profit oriented. Let us look at a private government agency. They provide the service basically to a common man. So each and every hospital, they had their own naming conventions, their own patient management system. But henceforth, it is better to have one system where it's shared across the entire hospital or entire province or entire country. So an enterprise can able to enable that, having one kind of a record for the patient. I worked in some hospitals. Unfortunately, every hospital, they had their own naming conventions. And finally, it was aggregated in the state level or in the national level. So now they're having time to get into one record for the patient. That is called EMR. Okay, let us look at the architecture. Every enterprise got an architecture. The architecture is nothing but physically, if you take, it can be in the buildings. If you take in terms of IT systems, the type of the system which support the ICT or the health aspects of the patient. So currently, what are the systems we're having? The systems what we're having, the systems what we're having is all is on-premises, generally 90%. Health industry is the last one to go into cloud. In fact, when I was working for eHealth in Australia, New South Wales, I was the first one to initiate to go towards cloud, and we did a POC for going into cloud. That is, I'm telling you, in 2017. So healthcare is very conservative. So it's still a lot of systems what you're having is on-premises. Again, the systems what we're having is generally like a black box. We don't know what it is because everything is proprietary based. They just expose some interfaces. So the architecture, again, we got some architecture based on on-premises and some architecture based on the cloud. So moving forward, we need to have an architecture, as I told you earlier, which is interoperable to get the real-time information as possible. And with COVID, you have seen it is very critical for the survival of humanity. Then let us look at what is enterprise architecture in general. It's a holistic approach that proactively realizes the business vision to utilize technology and abstracting the implementation. See, today we got example. We have before telehealth was not an option. Before a patient goes to a hospital, his treatment was given based on the hospital visit. With telehealth, the whole thing has changed. A patient can able to access. We can be having self-manage himself, he can able to self-book, self-service he can able to have. So the technology implementation is going to change. So what enterprise architecture says is separate the implementation from the actual capability. That is the objective of enterprise architecture. And to have policies across, I'll be explaining in the next slide. Okay, let us look at the conceptual model. See, as you can see here, we got a health record. The one health record means the health record will take the information from all across the patient where all is visited. It can be from a lab, it can be a clinic, it can be different hospitals. And one of the discussion when I was having with one of the event in Malaysia, they had the concept of womb to tomb. So womb to tomb means when they're going to manage the patient. So said that when do we capture the patient information? Yes, especially the modern technology, right from the womb, the baby is conceived, you can able to capture the information and keep it forever. But unfortunately still, as I discussed with many of my colleagues, in some countries, they're keeping it for 3 to 10 years. In some countries still it is paper-based, unfortunately, and is not even maintained. And next, so to have the health record, as you can see, the health record is only one system, what you're seeing. But the health record, as you can see, a patient, you cannot treat a patient by just taking one of the three parameter. The entire patient information, especially if it's an elderly patient having a lot of ailments, you must be having the entire profile of the patient. So said that a system is nothing but, especially in health system, we got n number of systems. They got n number of architectures. At the same time, we got different stakeholders. It can be the person who is maintaining the patient record, the person who is updating the patient record, the person who is treating the patient. You got so much of, based on the whole concern, you need to build a system. So similarly, how we have got, we treat a patient, and if especially getting X number of parameters, and at the same time, we get one single view to treat the patient. So similarly, you must get the health record combined from all the other places where all the patient has visited. And unfortunately, what I have come across is very few countries have this capability. Because one of the key things, the main reason is, especially private health institutions, they never share the patient record. That is the asset for them, and that's the business value. Okay, see, this is one of the proposed architecture I proposed long back, I think in 2015. And this is the way we need to go. We need to have the Ministry of Health. Under the umbrella, the enterprise architecture must be there. And you got different hospitals, of course, e-hospital. Under the e-hospital, you got different projects. Please remember this. This can be for a province, it can be for a country. This is the way we need to go. And India is going towards this path. They got the unique ID and they're trying to connect the patient EMR record. Of course, it's a long way to go. Australia has got this kind of a concept. They got the Ministry of Health in the federal, and they don't call it an enterprise architecture, but they have a strategy to have one record for the patient across. Though each state has got their own naming conventions, in the national level, it is all unified into one record. So that's the way we need to go. So in our case, as I told you, the three value chains. One is the patient, how the record need to be maintained. It can go as a single project, but it must be from the enterprise level. Similarly, for a doctor, how they're treating, what is the best way? Because now suddenly they're going to telehealth, that kind of a capability must be incorporated. And especially for the student, because my daughter is studying medical. She's in her first year. So almost 8 months, first 2 months she went to the university. Now 8 months she is studying from the home. So what's happening is she's supposed to have the clinics. Only on the clinics she'll visit the place. Otherwise it's all remote learning. The key factor here is this will be the future. Once the industry sees this can be enabled, the future will be on this pattern. So based on that, we need to revisit the curriculum such a way e-learning as well as remote telehealth must be incorporated in the curriculum. So let us look at the data strategy. Say, as I told you, one of the key thing, unfortunately, the patient record is not maintained or not captured. And especially if the patient record is destroyed after 10 years, where we are missing a valuable information. I'll be explaining again when I talk about innovation. So any enterprise is like a living enterprise repository. You must capture the information and able to maintain in real time as possible. And first time in the history, we are seeing, especially in COVID, every day we're getting the statistics, how many people are infected, how many people are treated, and how many people recovered, and how many people died. So the message here is, the first time we got this kind of an information, this must be for every possible scenarios, especially in treatment of a patient, must be enabled in the future. And with the current technology, what we're having, it is possible. It's not like the olden days. It is possible to achieve that kind of a capability. So, especially for moving forward, as I told you earlier, we take the concept of OOM to TOOM. So you must plan enterprise-wide to capture the data, collect it, store it. And one of the key things I've observed in the industry working with various customers, unfortunately, the patient record is not encrypted. So patient record has got mainly two things. One is at the time of receiving the patient record, storage, and sometimes in transmission to other partners. Unfortunately, some of the companies I've seen, even in some countries, they sometimes follow Excel or sometimes they follow some open source databases and it's not encrypted. So moving forward, database data must be encrypted, and I'll give you one of the reasons why it is. And it must be managed and analyzed. So one of the statistics I came across, they told because the patient record is not well managed, suppose a patient record is captured, the volume becomes 1 gig. By the time it is made some analysis and there's no proper pattern or policies, it becomes 10 gig. So 10 times getting multiplied. And sometimes it has become so huge and there'll be duplication and error in the results. Okay, then it must be visualizable. Unless it's visualizable, as you have seen, especially with COVID, with all the statistics, so it's easy to manage. And thus, especially whatever the data is there must be shared legally. That's a very important thing. Again, with COVID, you have seen, unless until the data is stored, I mean, well shared with other partners, we're not able to get the benefit of the data. Okay, let us look at the data breaches. Why it is so important to maintain the data. As you can see from here, Singapore is one of the best, government. So they itself, 1.5 million patients across breached. And in New South Wales, 54,000 driver license was exposed in the private cloud. And because of the COVID, just in the first half of 2020, 27 billion personal records were breached. And especially for hackers, driver's license is a key thing. And especially moving forward, some of the key aspects for is the privacy and confidential act of the patient. Some countries, unfortunately, they don't have that kind of an act. So there's no penalty. But especially in Europe, as well as in the developed countries, if the patient record is breached, the hospital or the private agency will be penalized. I just came across in Karnataka, just 2 months, I think last month, they came with a new ordinance of how to manage the personal record of the patient. Okay, then how to increase the success rate of the enterprise architecture? See, enterprise architecture, as you know, like the patient, if you get the information, if you got 10, 20 pages of information, it is not readable and it is very rarely it will be read by end to end. So at the same time, in enterprise architecture practices, unless it is modeled in a well-organized way and structured. So this is what we do. Any kind of enterprise architecture, we structure it depending on the various layers of the architecture. So because of this, what happens? It's easy to, like a Lego toys, to remove any of the non-performing bit of the model and replace with a new model, a new capability. So as you can see, telehealth was not an option. But telehealth has become the mainstream. Will become the mainstream in the future. Okay, what is the benefit of the modeling? Once you got a modeling, it is possible to get the complete view of the assets. See, especially in the health industry, it's very critical to have the patient record in real time as possible. And again, especially to share with the various partners. And again, with a tool having all the assets, which is well managed, we can able to simulate the different scenarios. So no government or no private agency expected the amount of patients getting treatment from telehealth. So if you have a proper tool, well managed with all the assets inside, you can able to simulate, able to find the best way to treat. And with the current technology, you can able to scale and implement in real time or in a very short time, the better way to treat the patient through telehealth. At the same time, you can able to trace any kind of a breaches. And as we go across, I'll be talking in the coming slides, there'll be a lot of issues in telehealth. Good and bad, okay. Let us look at how the technology can able to complement the healthcare. See, this is what pre-COVID, the option what we had is, we want to give as much as the facility to the customer remotely if possible. Some countries at least do not able to get the entire patient history. In Australia, they came with EMR, the electronic medical record, the personal health record, the patient can able to see. And again, based on his consent, he can able to share with other institutions or a healthcare facility. That is a pre-COVID. Let us look at the post-COVID. In the post-COVID, what the industry has realized is not only able to give, at this moment, the country is closed, once they'll be coming here. And once the university sees this model, it's very, commercial value is very high, having remote learning. Then the lessons is given by remote, even the exams is done by remote. And it's one of the key things, the 50th convocation IIT happened remote, against remote avatars. So this will be the future. The education industry will be completely changing. So this must be incorporated in the health sector. Compared to other health sectors, the student and the doctors, they get trained, they work in work together. So it's a very important thing to upgrade the curriculum to reflect the changing environment of telehealth. So what technologies can able to assist the telehealth? So one of the key thing is we can able to measure the blood pressure, blood glucose, lung functions. And I saw there's a portable ventilator too. And wearable devices automatically capture the vital information of the patient. So it's all very key success for telehealth. And especially for elderly people. In COVID, what we saw, elderly people were the one more prone to diseases, especially with COVID. So having all this telehealth well-defined and well-managed, so that could be prevented in the future. So as you know, you're all for medical professionals, COVID is not the first thing, nor the last thing. So this kind of a pandemic or this kind of what we call the coronavirus can be mutated and we can expect more. So this one of the model what we are proposing. So what we are proposing is every information in the patient will be in the cloud and you can able to manage the information there. And just for information, see if I go from Australia to any part of the world, I am tracked because I got my mobile phone. And if I go to any country, I can able to get my new SIM based on my ID. But unfortunately, the health record is not that way. So I was born in India. I don't have access to any of my health record. My daughter was born in Singapore. My son is born in Australia. At least I could able to get access to my son's data. But my daughter's data, I don't know, in 2002, they had any kind of a EMR system in Singapore. But at the same time, I can able to go and look back my bank records in Singapore, partially in India too. So the message here is, unless the patient record was not given such importance, because of privacy acts and because of some kind of conservation. But moving forward, this must not be the case. With the way the industry is changing, the genomic innovation and research, the records of the patient need to be captured right from the concealment till the tomb, as I told you. Okay, in this proposed model, we can able to get all the information. The payer is the one, it can be insurance company or policymaker or the government in some developed countries. And the registrant and by the patient, and you can able to have everything on the fly. And many times we use social media as in some places. Yes, it is not so vital. We can use social media if it's need basis. Okay, what we are trying to propose is some of the statistics when I went through, what they're telling is they become fake doctors for treating the patients. So there must be a central portal defined by a country. So the country must be able, this is a long-term plan. So anyone must go there, able to register. Then the website must be definitely friendly. And there must be a record of the medical professionals for legal to practice. And telehealth, for the first time who are logging in, the information must be captured. Because especially there'll be a lot of fraud in insurance and other aspects. And again, the treatment given to the patient, you must see that the right patient is able to get the right treatment. And patient must be able to, again, I read a lot of articles. So again, some of the research. Health is such a double-edged sword. Some hospitals, they're treating the patient, but some hospitals are make misuse of the COVID. They're exorbitantly charging the patients. So there must be a service catalog to list the cost of the health services. So it becomes transparent. And patient must be able to be given the choice to choose whichever the doctor they prefer. And the documents, whatever is been there, must be in a digital format. It must be stored. All the conversation must be stored forever. So if any legal requirement, it can be revisited. And at the same time, data is collected, will be able to help for further research. Then, how can we make the innovation? So COVID has enabled us enormous amount of data. Let us take an example of a doctor. What does a doctor do? Before giving a treatment to a patient, he's capturing some vital information. Might be a heartbeat or might be the pulse. So all this is the information. But unfortunately, all this information is not captured at this moment. Unless in emergency, some of the systems may capture. Moving forward with telehealth, every information can be captured. So that itself is an asset. Then, and again, many countries don't have a proper practice, especially which is related to human-centered relation, the privacy acts and all. This need to be revisited. See, I was talking about enterprise architecture. The enterprise architecture is the one which enables right across what kind of government requirements or international requirements that need to be implemented across the enterprise. It can be hospitals, it can be clinics, what is to be standardized. That can be enforced only with enterprise architecture. Then let us look at just a high level. The information that is captured, must be of useful. To make it useful, we must be having the most important thing we call artificial intelligence. The building blocks are machine learning. Machine learning is nothing but teaching the computers to make some decisions. The amount of data we're collecting with the patient henceforth will be enormous. So once it is stored and the computers are taught, again, we'll not be teaching. There are some systems, there are some algorithms. Then deep learning is nothing but improving the data sets. See, especially with the amount of data we're collecting with the patients remotely. And again, there's a new thing called open data, the data that can be shared, which is useful for the society. So said that there'll be huge amount of data across the world, which is, it will be the privacy, which has been, excluded, or it will be encrypted, it will be shared across. So huge amount of data will be generated. So with all that, we got something called neural network. Means we cannot replace the human brain, but we can able to simulate. So with that, we can able to find out some kind of new algorithms that can able to give a better health service, at the same time bring the cost of the health service. Okay, and one of the key thing, as I told you earlier, many countries don't have data security, privacy, and ethics, especially with patient record. So we must be able to make a mandate. The data that has been captured of a patient, even at rest, it must be encrypted. Even at motion, it must be encrypted. And using all the algorithms, what happens is, some of the algorithms is like a black box. You give some information, it comes out. But the algorithm under the designer, you can able to capture the information. But there's new things happening in the industry. It's called homomorphic encryption. So the record can be encrypted and the algorithms can be run on that. We can able to make some kind of analytics. And countries level, they must able to set up some kind of a data ethics. And telehealth, One of the key thing in the telehealth is how to capture the user information. See, having a India itself is coming with a unique ID in the last 3-4 years, and many countries don't have a unique ID. So how to capture the patient information? Now there's a technology, we can able to, based on the iris or retina of the patient, we can able to capture the information. And based on the fingerprint, we can able to capture the information. So now you can able to imagine how much of data we're capturing. Okay, this is one of the example how telehealth is already been enabled in some of the countries, and the same thing can be utilized or complemented for other services too. And as you can see here, how much of vital signs, how much of information is captured 24/7, and how much of useful information. And to make use of all this useful information, as I told you earlier, we need artificial intelligence. And to manage the data across, we need enterprise architecture. Okay, this is a new concept. It's called digital twin. It's happening in the industry now. All these years, medical industry did not have the capability to capture the data. Even the data was captured was in paper format. It was of not of much use unless for the patient or the specific context. But moving forward, capturing the record of the patient in real time, so we can able to get the vital signs of the patient, and we can able to simulate. So if a patient, the moment he comes, we can have a history in the last 6 months, how the patient was behaving. So based on that, we can able to get a simulation of the patient, and giving a treatment becomes much more easier. So as I told you earlier, the curriculum need to be revisited. The reason why the future doctors, the younger generation who are becoming the doctors, they must be taught of how to manage the patients with the new technology. Only with this kind of an aspect, we can able to reach more patients, at the same time bring the cost of the service down, and improve the quality of service for the patients. Okay, let us say I am telling all this information, and how as a company we can help you. So as I told you, let us take telehealth. Telehealth, the moment it came in, because it's a tactical model. So what we do is, if a company wants to have, it can be a university, it can be a hospital. So what we do is, first of all, we assess what kind of transformation we need, the company needs. Then we determine the expectation. The expectation means it depending on the capacity, the funding they're having. At the same time, what kind of maturity they're having. So then we make an assessment of the maturity, what kind of capability they're having. So based on that, we set up an EA practice and we build a tool. As I told you earlier, without a tool, it's not possible to get the real-time information. So once we do build that tool, then we put a roadmap, what can be done. Again, it all depends on the budget and the commitment of the company or the hospital. Then we customize the methodology, how it can be implemented. Then, as I told you earlier, skills will be changing forever, especially with this digital transformation. Today we got AI, we got machine learning. Tomorrow what it comes, we don't know. So what we do is, but we as the researchers and innovation, we'll be keeping track of what's happening in the technology arena and bring it back, and depending on the customer, we tell what skills is needed for them. Then we assist even for the RFP, RFQ. So key takeaways. The key takeaway is, because of COVID, the health industry went for telehealth. But it's a tactical way. Again, the tactical way, what we are recommending is, please capture the patient records. We can provide you with the forms which is HIPAA compliant. And from that, you can able to make some use of it. At least the patient record is captured. It can be useful for research further. Then we must revisit the health value chain, mainly the patient treatment, how the doctor is treating the patient, and how the doctor is educating the medical student. Again, the medical student value chain is a very important thing, because it must be combined with remote learning plus remote treating the patient. Then to realize this, we need enterprise architecture. If we don't have an enterprise architecture, it's not able to get a real-time view of the enterprise. Plus again, what are the compliances to be followed and how to govern and enforce across the enterprise. And please use a tool. Without a tool, it is not possible to get an real-time information. See, something like we got radiology. So before radiology, you're using some kind of a technique to look at a patient. With radiology, you can able to get a complete analysis. So similarly, how we have a radiology, that is the way we need to have an EA tool to realize it. Then technology must be complemented for the healthcare. Without technology, we cannot able to give the value to the patient. Then again, with technology, the data it is captured must be retained for the lifetime, first thing. And the second most important thing, you must be able to use the technology right from capturing the user information, especially the fingerprints, the retina and all, so is able to easily authenticate and give the patient a treatment. And with AI, you can able to get heuristics and some of the common patterns. So with this, you can able to provide a better experience and better health service for the patient. So thank you for all for the wonderful session. I hope you enjoyed.
Yes, okay. So the question, Doctor, many organizations are shifting from on-premises applications to the cloud. So how can EA help with this transition?
Okay. See, when you want to go from on-premises to cloud, one of the key things you need to assess the current systems, what you're having. Without the EA practice, if you want to shift the systems from on-prem to cloud, it does not work. The main reason is cloud is not meant for the systems what has been designed for on-prem. Your on-prem systems are designed for vertical scaling, but cloud is designed for horizontal scaling. Again, as I told you in one of my slides earlier, the systems what an enterprise is having, it has come at various timelines. With enterprise architecture, we can able to make the assessment. What is the capability based on the current environment an enterprise needs? So based on the capability, we can able to see what kind of technology stack is needed. And based on that technology stack, we can able to choose which cloud vendor meets the requirements. So said that only with enterprise architecture approach, it is possible. Without enterprise architecture, if we do, what happens? It can become like a silo. One department you take, you shift. Again, other department will come. So it does not work. With enterprise architecture, it's holistic approach you will be taking.
Yes, thank you, Dr. Sunil. I think our participants are needing help in the forum. I think okay, they need permission to access it.
Oh, there's no permission, is it?
Maybe the forum is limited to your network, Dr. Sunil.
Okay, please answer it. Okay.
I can also send the link after the webinar as a follow-up
okay, no to problem. Our participants. Okay. Give me the questions. I can answer. Any other questions, please?
Okay, let me just check the questions again. Maybe we can accommodate one more question.
Please, go ahead.
Yes, enterprise architecture is a difficult concept for many. So how can you convince a minister of health with non-technical knowledge to adapt EA?
Oh, it is a very valid question. We can take COVID as a good example. With COVID, what we saw, the information was not properly shared. And one of the key things what we realized is some of the way the systems were designed was not meant to design in that way. So with enterprise architecture, there's standard practice that can be enforced across a country or a province. So for a minister, we can able to give an example of COVID. Without enterprise architecture, what happens? Still, there'll be the companies or the hospitals or the what I can say is the private agencies will be working on their own way. With enterprise architecture, we can able to streamline, standardize across. So with that, what happens is we're not only creating transparency, we're creating standard building blocks that can be reused. One of the key things of enterprise architecture is reusing the assets. So if a country is able to define the architectural building blocks, what is needed for a health industry, and the same thing will be utilized across different hospitals or different provinces. That itself is a big saver. Not only big saver, it's timely to the market. If you don't have enterprise architecture, they'll be doing on their own way, and we don't able to get the results even after years. So it's enterprise architecture, it saves the cost, and because of the immediate action, it saves the lives of the patients. And if you're not able to convince, invite us, we'll come and convince your minister. That's our job.
Thank you, Dr. Sunil. To wrap up our session, may we call on our executive director, Dr. Alvin Marcelo?
Yeah, please.
Thank you, Cha. Thank you, Sunil. Very interesting presentation. For those who are in the audience and who are interested in enterprise architecture, we have a subgroup in AHIN who are talking enterprise architecture. Sunil, you might not know, but AHIN is now a member of the TOGAF Healthcare Forum.
Oh, great. We okay.
We got a grant from GIZ, so we were able to subscribe. We have 4 slots in the healthcare forum. But that allows us to get access to artifacts like reference, health reference architectures, hospital enterprise architectures, which we can share to the AHIN members. So for those who are in the audience tonight, if you want to join that subgroup of AHIN interested in enterprise architecture, especially healthcare, please inform Charisse at webmaster@ahin.net and we will include you in that mailing list. For those who want to take on enterprise architecture as a career, we encourage you to study TOGAF. Sunil was my teacher in 2013. I took his course, his class on TOGAF in Ulaanbaatar, Mongolia. But I had to study for 3 years, Sunil, before I took the exam. Of course, I passed it. Thank you to Sunil. And also to Vish, because Vish was the one who helped me get the voucher. For those who are interested in enterprise architecture as a career, I encourage you to join our working group. The concept is a little vague, and it becomes clearer when you start practicing it. So when you start your enterprise architecture practice, it becomes much clearer. And then suddenly, one of the days after you've started practicing it, you will start asking yourself, how did we ever survive without an enterprise architecture? It's really very important to have a blueprint, especially when you're building very expensive and maintaining very big information systems like electronic medical records. So Sunil, thank you very much. I hope we can invite you again in the future. And to everyone in the call right now, good night. Please email Charisse if you want to join the Enterprise Architecture Working Group. Stay safe, everyone. Thank you, Sunil. Good night.
Yeah, thanks, Dr. Alvin. I really appreciate this. And for all the audience, for your patience. And as Dr. Alvin told, I'm really humbled, Dr. Alvin, with your kind words. Definitely, as Dr. Alvin told, EA is the only way to really realize the benefit for any organization. It can be health, it can be any government agency, it can be any sector. Thank you all.
Thank you, Sunil. Okay, join our group. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. Thanks.
Good night.
Good night. Good night. Good night, all.